lecture we've had in the ISI Fall Lecture Series this year, which has been around migration stories. And this talk is, we're lucky to have Dr. Diao here, who's from the University of Arizona. She is both in, actually that's a pretty good idea, you can clap. she is in the East Asian Studies program, as well as the Second Language Acquisition Teaching Program, SLAT, which sounds pretty cool. And she does a lot of her work on language pedagogy, so learning how to speak foreign languages, especially in the context of study abroad programs, which is certainly something that's very important to a lot of you, especially if you're international studies majors. And she also does a lot of her work concerning China, which I also know is an interesting topic, possible study abroad destination for a lot of you. So I think this is going to be very interesting, very valuable. And so without further ado, I will pass it over to her.
Thank you so much for that very, very 说这句话的时候就像个男人。你这是疯子啊！
对，所以就我觉得就是女生，
对女生有时候就会装可爱，
对，但是我的意思就是，不，其实不管你知道都是什么样的，你的朋友会说啊，太可爱啊，啊，太 sexy 啦，就是这样的，就是，对，是不是？所以这个是好的事情，其实。每个人应该听啊，我好看。
表扬别人，赞扬。
表对对对，
赞扬。
对。
这接下来像一个
那是为了那个广东的室友唱唱船。
我知道。
对对对。因为我真的因为他们用广东话的时候有啊有啊啊啊，他们常常说，所以他们用普通话，他们就习惯用啊 ，They want to sound like the same rhythm。
但是在这里女生可以用呀。
Yeah， 对，我在来这儿也哪个女生都说啊，好啊，好啊，
好呀，但是男生不要打，男生不要用。
为什么？
真的，男生不要用。
我相信你也觉得在这儿他们不用啊，我也觉得。但是告诉你去广东，我在广东学习是吧？在广东，哪个男生用啊？
我知道，我相信你，我认识广东人，我相信你。
是
在，
但是在这儿房子几百吧，贵吧？
对，
不就是
男的
房产整，不像
男的听起来像一个 gay，
对，
也不是像 gay 吧，就是。像一个女人。
I have a little bit of time for a question. So I wanted to invite actually someone who was referenced in my talk, Dr. Trentman, who is a professor here at UNM. She works primarily in Arabic, but does a lot of the same similar research on language pedagogy and study abroad, the utility of study abroad, the challenges of study abroad, and so forth. So I wanted to invite her to step up as well, and maybe they might have, not exactly dueling answers, but they might have some comments on each other's answers to any questions you have. So does anyone have any questions to ask?
Yeah, Emma has some very interesting stuff about gender too.
I
was just wondering, so you talked about like I guess the polarization between like Northern Chinese and Southern Chinese, and it's kind of like the same in the US. And is it like necessarily racist? Like do you think it's like something that, or is it more classist? Like it's something that people down with people like from Taiwan or Southern China, like based on their ethnicity, or like is it mainly classist?
Yeah, that's a very good question. So in the past, it was just region, just like all these different European languages. They're just distributed in different parts of Europe. But what's actually happening now, a lot of linguists would argue that, so that's vertical distribution of language are becoming, or you know, this horizontal distribution of languages that are just in different parts of the time, are becoming verticalized, that standard Mandarin is becoming associated with education, definitely, and so forth on class, to some extent as well. And then not every single other variety is the same. Some variety is still seen as more prestigious, such as Taiwan Mandarin, for example, because Taiwan and Singapore, these are places that are more active, and they have been invested in the China. And so that's probably why the transnational culture movement, and so that's also why young people are learning and appropriating these cultural practices because they think it's cool and cute. So there are other regional actors that are seen as less civilized. And that's probably partially why the roommates are correcting the actors. So for example, we have a question about that. Hassan project was seen as not cool, but not educated. And that's why we were trying so hard to get them to see. Oh, but because people there are learning the answer, they don't have to sound like that. So yes, it's becoming that, but it's still not the way that we have to say in a way that it's not, we don't see the sort of like the change in that way. Right now, it's not going that way. It's going the opposite way. That people are associating standard with more with prestige. What's happening right now? I think I've posted a lot about that there was even robots that will teach children standard Mandarin because parents, there are so many anxieties about these parents who feel that they don't speak standard enough, so they need to have for their parents. But they need to buy these robots to teach their young children to speak the standard. So there are a lot of anxieties going on right now with non-standard. So it's not going well. So
other questions?
How is the question of second language acquisition like reconciled or changed when gender is also tied to race and culture? I know you touched on it a little bit, but if there's certain gender norms that exist, how does that language acquisition come for someone that might not otherwise experience those gender norms?
Yeah, so it's a very good question. We do, I think, we always experience gender norms of our speech. But I think what happens is sometimes when it's in a second language, we become more salient, and sometimes there's a conflict between, you know, perhaps how I want to represent myself as part of a certain gender in cultures I'm familiar with, and how I'm expected to represent myself as a women abroad in a different cultural context. And so this is when Wenhao was talking about really understanding the local cultural codes. That is something that comes up over and over as really important, and so not necessarily interpreting gendered experiences that we have abroad based on how they might be interpreted in the United States. And so, for example, something that came up in my research is that women would always complain about getting calls on the street, like cat calls, but for some of their Egyptian roommates, positive cat calls, like, oh, you're very beautiful, were seen as acceptable if they came from an attractive person. And so sort of developing those nuances of what was never acceptable, touching, more negative cat calls, and what could possibly be interpreted as acceptable was something that was very challenging. And there's lots of other examples as well. Something that also comes up in terms of gender, and this both looked at this is access. So in my studies, again, women felt that they couldn't just chat with people on the street because they would get harassed, and so that prevented them from having access to conversations in Arabic. However, this wasn't entirely true because it was much easier for them to spend time with Egyptian families or to stay overnight, which is almost unheard of, or to stay with a host family, which is much more difficult for a male student. And so, again, understanding sort of what opportunities for access are available to you for practicing the language, and then sort of reconciling with how you feel about that. So maybe you feel like, well, I should just be able to talk to you however I want, but you can't. And so, again, sort of understanding those local nuances is how it's called.
Yeah. And also, the concept that gender performance is not universal, and gender is also not the same as biological sex. And so, for example, with regard to birth.